Hi everyone, I'm Maë Guéguen, and coming after the presentations of Wilfred Thuillet and Damien Georges, I will talk about some biomod specificities. Here is a global workflow of biomod presented by Wilfred to obtain distribution models and projections for one species. I will first go a bit in details about pseudo-absences and how to select them. Then I will introduce ensemble modeling, and finally, talk about the variability you can find in your models and how to interpret it. So let's start with pseudo-absence data that are needed in biomod 2 when your data is presence only. Pseudo-absences, also sometimes referred as background data, should not be seen as absences, but rather as the available environment in your studied area that will be combined with your presence data, on the contrary to presence only techniques. The model will contrast observed used environment against what is available. About the terms, usually pseudo-absences are preferred over background data when targeting a particular species, meaning that you might do some assumptions about its ecology. In that case, the term background data may not be relevant anymore, as you will in a way constrain the available environment to your species specificities. Which leads me to the main question about pseudo-absences. How to select them, in which area, and with which method? This hides, in fact, another and maybe more important question, which is, how were obtained my presence points? Was there a sampling design? If yes, what was the purpose, the scope, the hypothesis? And in any case, what were the potential sources of bias? Did the data explore the entire range of the species, or focalize on a specific area and why? What was the method used? Was it biased? Were there several observers? Did they have the same instructions or training, and so on? The idea is that you want both to be aware of potential bias and, at the same time, try to minimize those that you might add. For example, here is a map of all the species occurrences of G. beef in 2020. Clearly, there seems to be more occurrences in developed countries, which is a spatial bias. In Biomod 2 package, four different methods are implemented to select pseudo-absences: the random method, the disk method, surface range envelope, and points directly defined by the user. The random method should be the default choice, since it's the one with the least assumptions. It does not account for environment or geography and depends on no ecological assumption. The disk method, with which pseudo-absences are drawn within disks around presence points defined by minimal and maximal distance, should be used when the geographical area of the species is well defined by the presence data. So it does not account for environment, since it relies on the assumption that the realized niche of the species has been fully sampled, and therefore its environmental conditions. Beware, if used while the sampling was not exhaustive, it will reinforce this bias. Finally, the surface range envelope model selects pseudo-absence points outside the environment considered to be favorable to the species, meaning the environment defined by the presence data. This time, it means that the environmental area of the species has been fully sampled, otherwise models will increase the bias included in the presence dataset. Barbier, Massin et al. Try to answer the how, where, and how many pseudo-absences should be selected when doing species distribution modeling. In other words, is there a somehow best method to define pseudo-absences? To do so, they evaluate the relative effect of method and number of pseudo-absences on predictive accuracy of common modeling techniques using biomod. The study relied on three initial biased distributions, either climatically or spatially, and four sample sizes of presences. For each dataset, they used four different methods to generate pseudo-absences: one random, one surface range envelope, and two disks, and five sample sizes. And used these different datasets obtained with each of seven modeling techniques, through regression to classification and to machine learning. More details can be found in the article, but general results were that GLM and GAM obtained better results when selecting large number of absences, while MAS and MDA had better results when averaging several ones with few absences, all having presences and absences weighted equally. CTA and classification methods obtain better results when selecting the same amount of absences as available presences. Our main advice, although no rule is perfect for every situation, is to use a random method when no strong assumption can be made, and especially when high specificity is valued over high sensitivity, in particular for conservation policy, to select 3 times more absences than presences, and to run 10 repetitions. More generally, remember that before running any model, you should give a good thought to the scope and the purpose of your analysis, as well as to your study area. And if possible, do not hesitate to add prior assumptions linked to the species ecology when sampling the absences. But you don't have to make it up. If there is none, and choose a random method. You should also keep in mind that you will build a model which is only a representation of your data and the assumptions you make of it. And the choices you make at each step may lead you to a different pattern or outcome. Which brings me to the next part, the ensemble modeling. As we presented you now with a lot of biomat functionalities, you may wonder which model to use, which method should be used, which data should be selected to calibrate and or evaluate the model obtained, on which criteria should the results be evaluated. In 5 words, what is the best model? But, and this only if we agree that we chose the more adequate performance metric, the value obtained will only be representative of this particular dataset that we used over this particular area that we define for this particular modeling method we chose. All of these are factors that, if changed, will potentially change the results and therefore the value of the performance metric. 2 broad underlying questions arise from this. What is then the best model for one particular species? As results may change under different geographical or environmental conditions resulting from different sampling, also some models can be more sensitive than others to sampling bias. As for the performance metric, 2 different models can show the same value but imply different results. And this becomes even more complex when modeling and try and compare several species, as one set of environmental variables can be adequate for one species but not for another, and best performance values may be obtained with different modeling techniques. All this points to the need for a method that can both compare models with each other and estimate variability. As you may have guessed, it's ensemble modeling. An ensemble model is derived from the multi-model inference, which relies on multiple candidates with no variable selection and weight each model based on an information criterion. Initially, it was developed as an alternative to stepwise procedure. Unlike multi-model inference, ensemble modeling is not based on likelihood, but rather on metrics of predictive performance such as AUC or TSS. It allows to map both the main trend across all models, as well as the overall variation within a model type and between model types. In Biomat 2, 6 methods are implemented, allowing you to run several models for one species and then calculate the main trend across the prediction of all of these models, the mean or the median, and the coefficient of variation, calculate the confidence interval around the mean trend, estimate the weighted sum of all models' prediction weighted by the selected evaluation method scores, and estimate the committee averaging scores of all models, that is the average of all binary predictions. All these computations can be made at different grouping levels, depending on the outcome expectations. For example, let's say that we built 2 pseudabsence datasets and run 2 models, GLM and Random Forest, with 3 repetitions each. The Then we can combine all of these models in 5 different ways to obtain ensemble models. The default combines together models with the same pseudabsence dataset and repetition, meaning that the same points are used in all models for calibration and validation. The different models obtained, if compared to one another, with an expressed variability between the data used. The second combines models with the same pseudabsence dataset and algorithm used. The third combines models with the same pseudabsence dataset. And the fourth, models with the same algorithm. Finally, you can combine all your models into one ensemble model. So now that we have a way to combine models, or at least evaluate them at different grouping levels, one point stays unclear. I still have many ways of creating pseudabsence datasets, of choosing variables and algorithms, and of combining them at the end. Hence, depending on my choices, I can still have a lot of different models and results with more or less variability between them. First thing first, I must quickly address a syntax point. Must I refer to these differences in outcomes as variability or uncertainty? Looking out into dictionaries' definitions, variability is globally defined as the extent to which data points in a statistical distribution or dataset diverge from the average value, or how spread out a set of data is. Uncertainty, on the other hand, is a situation in which something is not known. Peng et al. Discussed the differences between these two words, and what mainly come out of it is that variability should be used when speaking of a distribution of quantities derived from observed data, while uncertainty represents a probability distribution of the unknown quantity, more or less precise depending on our state of knowledge. From here, I will talk about variability in results or outcomes and reserve the term of uncertainty when speaking of the true results of the models, like there is most of the time uncertainty in defining a species fundamental niche. So, in what variability are we interested in here? As discussed along this presentation, the variability in results may come from the selected dataset, the pronounces like the environmental predictors, the selection of pseudabsences, the selection of environmental predictors by the model used, and at last, the variability in the results in themselves. I will not discuss of the variability coming from the selection of environmental predictors, as this is done automatically by the models in Biomod 2. Going back to the example shown by Damien Georges in its presentation, we modeled the distribution of Protea lorifolia using 3 sets of pseudabsences selected with a random strategy, 4 different algorithms, and 4 repetitions for each combination. Part 1a of code allows you to build the following graph, which must be different than mine, as you would have selected different pseudabsences and different lines for the cross-validation. On the x-axis, different performance measures and their values on the y-axis. Variability comes from repetition. Different colors indicate intermodal variability in terms of predictive performance, while different box plots of same color show variability between sets of pseudabsences. The height of each box plot indicates intramodal variability. In this example, the second set of pseudabsence seems to produce results with lower kappa and TSS measures, regardless of the model. Here is the same example with new model runs. There seems to be more consistency between pseudabsence datasets. Part 2a of code represents this time the importance of each variable within each model. Globally, all models agree that Bio19, the precipitation of code as quarter, is the most important variable to describe the distribution of Protea lorifolia. On the other hand, GLM models, especially those with the third set of pseudabsences, seem to disagree on the importance of the other variables. Part 2b of code allows you to represent the same graphic, but at the ensemble model level, given that you selected the var import parameter when running the BioMAD Ensemble modeling function. Here, the ensemble model compiled all models together. Results are shown for community averaging, coefficient of variation, and mean tendency, confirming that Bio19 is the most important variable compared to the three others. Finally, even if you found out that all your models have good and similar predictive performance values, you can still find variability in the results. Here are shown the projections of all models built with the first pseudoabsence dataset. And here is the coefficient of variation calculated thanks to the ensemble modeling method and highlighting areas where the projections differ. The more yellow is the area, the higher is the coefficient of variation, meaning that projection outputs differ between each other and variability in results is higher. So what are the take-home messages of this presentation? First one is that you must know your data and ideally the ecology of the species that you want to model. Second, that there will always be an uncertainty as to whether the model distribution corresponds to the real one, but you can try and understand it by exploring the variability found in your results and coming from your modeling choices. And that there is no best model, but if needed, ensemble modeling method can help you provide you a mean tendency. Thanks for listening.